around 1 o'clock. I tend to miss the target often. And generally end about 1:30. So I'm on time today. So I don't want you to think about lunch for about half an hour. I just want you to listen to what I'm going to say, and then I'll send you to lunch. You should be at lunch about 1:30. Just relax, enjoy that. And I think there's lunch. I hope there's lunch downstairs. So if you want to join the rest downstairs for lunch after the sermon today, you are welcomed. I'm exercising a lot of faith here. Because if all of you show up for lunch, we may have to pray heavily on that lunch. Today I have chosen to speak with you from a little story found in the book of Luke chapter 15. The planners have chosen to use the theme today, God's transforming grace. So I want to talk a little about grace this morning. And I've picked that passage found in Luke chapter 15, where the Bible says, beginning at verse 11, that a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the portion of my goods that falleth to me." He divided unto them his living. Not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country. There he wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. He would fain have filled his belly with the husk the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, "How many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father. Will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me one of thy hired servants." And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. The son said unto him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I'm no more worthy to be called thy son." But the father said to his servants, "Bring forth the best robe. Bring forth the best robe. Put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring hither the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat. Let us be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. This my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to make merry. Story is known. It's often referred to as the story of the prodigal son. And if you consider the word prodigal and you inquire into its meaning, you would learn that the word prodigal can otherwise be translated excessive, extravagant, wasteful, so by way of definition, we can understand this word prodigal to refer to or describe what I may call one's lavish behavior, whether it is directed at yourself. You can be lavish with yourself. In the case of that boy in the story. Or to another. As was the case of his father. And so we may be prompted to ask the question, who really was the prodigal in this story? Some have suggested that the father was more of a prodigal than the son. But tradition has assigned the term the prodigal to that son. And as we look at this story, though, we learn that the father was just as squanderous as his son. For that father squandered all he had for the boy. Look at the story and we discover that boy coming to his father asking for his inheritance. Now, at face value, that seemed okay. But if you understand that one typically does not receive his inheritance until the death of somebody. So coming to his father to ask for his inheritance, on face value may seem not to be a bad thing. You know, as a matter of fact, those of us who are parents and have children, you don't mind those babies. They stress you out during the teenage years. And when they get to college and they graduate, you want them out. When I graduated college, I did not go back home. I was gone at about age 18. Headed out to college and didn't come back. But I understand that there is a trend in today's generation. There is this trend that now they leave for a while and check things out.
And then they tell you they're coming in for the weekend. And the weekend then gets stretched into Monday. And Tuesday, they're still there. Next week, still there. Next month, still there. So the boy comes to the daddy and says, "Dad, I like my share now because I want to go out and start living on my own." That was very radical when you consider the Jewish culture at the time. It was radical and it was heartless. For in real terms, that boy was wishing for his father to be dead. "I can't wait for you to die. So give me my portion now." It's cruel, ungrateful. But one may say, legal. So yes, his father says the story, gives him his portion. The boy took his portion and left. Understand, what we are talking about here in the story is not just a man and his son. We are talking about ourselves and God. God being our father and we being his children. Understand that sin is more than breaking just rules and laws. Typically, that boy should have waited until the death of his father, until the will was read and he got his portion. But when that boy left the house that day, he was breaking not just a rule, but a relationship. Walking out on house and home and dad was going to damage the very relationship that existed between himself and his father. And that is what sin is, by the way. So this son did not just break the rules as much as he broke his father's heart. And so the father lets him go. Father stays at home with a broken heart. My brothers and my sisters, as we look at that boy and try to see ourselves in this story, I hasten to ask you the question, how often have we broken our Heavenly Father's heart? How often have we broken our Father's heart? I submit and I suggest to you this morning that we break the heart of God every time we resist God's control over us. We break his heart. We break God's heart every time we refuse to accept God's guidance. We break his heart. We break God's heart any and every time we renounce God's goodness. We break God's heart. And every time we seek to do things by ourselves and we turn our backs on the source, the true source of life that comes from God, we break God's heart. So So we walk away from God and we leave the house. And I want to assume this morning that maybe some of us can identify with this. Many of us may have picked up our share of our inheritance, and we have left the Father's house long time. Notice the story says, the boy not just left and went down the street, went to Connecticut, or just crossed the river to Jersey. The story says the boy took off and went to a far country. He wanted to sever all ties with house and home. That sounds like rebellion to me. One commentator describes it as a deliberate act of departure. He renounced his dependent sonship. Broke all ties. Gone. Had no intention of coming back. And then the story says that as that young man began to enjoy himself and began to spend the money, you know, I learned one thing about money in my little life so far. Hey, when you get it, you have some of it. Looks like a lot. I got $2,000. Maybe I can spend a little bit. I've discovered in my own experience that money has a way of just vanishing into thin air. Where did all the money go? Has that ever happened to you? It happened to me last month. Man, when you begin to spend and there's one bill and there's bill number two, and by the time you get to bill number four, where did all the money go? Did it? So that young man begins to spend the money, and the story says the money ran out. The money ran out. Lord have mercy. In a far country? No money? Yeah? Now, we were down in St. Croix a few weeks ago, and I was just looking around with amazement and remembering so many things from my childhood. Remember when we could just live without money? Have you ever been back there? Because we can go around the backyard and from the breadfruit tree, you pick a breadfruit there. And you walk around the breadfruit tree and there's a banana tree there. You can pluck out a few grains of banana there. And down behind where the water ran off from the kitchen and all of that, there we had some dasheen growing, and that's what we call callaloo. Yeah. And of course there was some seasoning peppers back there, and some salve and thyme, and yeah. They said Lucian wants some coconut milk. And I had a favorite thing, which I still do at the house. My wife says, I want an oil down. The Jamaicans will call it something else. Run down. But there was a time when you could just live without money. Here's this young man in a far country, and he's dead broke.
Now, to add insult to injury, there is a famine in the land. So now, not only is he broke, there's no food. There's no food.
So he looks for a job, and the only thing available is that with this farmer that,
and the man isn't planting corn, the man has pigs. Now, my wife and I, after we got married, our first home was a nice little house on a hill. We had one neighbor, one close neighbor. Nice people. They had a nice house. Husband was a policeman, and the wife was a nurse. And the children attended the high school, and my wife was a teacher there, and nice things. And there was just one problem. It was just one problem.
That man would rear a pig every year. That pig will be reared and prepared for Christmas. Anybody know about that? That was just one problem. The pig. And the pig was kept on the outside under a tree and fed there. And somehow the pig's home was just on the fence there between his house and our house. So as we, my wife and I, would be often relaxing and enjoying our beautiful home, and the afternoon breeze would be coming from the west. Man, that pig was...
Oh, I can smell him even now.
This boy finds a job, and the only job that he finds is with this farmer who is rearing pigs.
So he's broke. He's hungry. Now he is stink. What a combination. Now, you may know that this story is not far-fetched. How often, for example, have you seen a young girl? She's tired of parental authority. She wants to leave the house. She wants to move on. And before you know it, she has one baby, then two. And from there on, it's not far-fetched. Some young person is listening to the preacher this morning. You better listen to your parents. Because like I say to my kids all the time, and my mom used to say, my mom is probably listening to me right now. She listens to me every Sabbath. And then she'll call me on Sunday, and if I make any errors here today, she'll tell me about it tomorrow,
My mom used used to say to us kids, what you are aiming at, somebody knew it. What you are aiming at, I have already shot. So when your parents say to you, kids, when your parents says, leave that boy alone. Leave the boy alone. It's not your mother don't want you to have a boyfriend, but not that boy. Because you have no clue that your mom has seen 15 of these boys before. And she knows exactly what he's up to. She can smell him. What they say, I can smell him from a mile off. So this boy traded home and went off. It's not really a far-fetched story, for often we flee legitimate authority only to become enslaved to some illegitimate authority. Some of our young people, it's drugs. You want to try it, then you get hung on it. It's not good. So the young man now is at his very bottom. He's down at his lowest ebb, at his lowest low. And the Bible says that in that place and at that time, he comes to himself. He's thinking one day, man, what have I done? He comes to himself. This means that he saw himself as he truly was. You know, it isn't easy to take an honest look at yourself. You know that. You know that we fool ourselves all the time. But he came to himself, and the Bible says he spoke to himself, said, self? Self must have answered, yes. What are you doing here? I will get up and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. And so the son begins a long journey home. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us give us all the details about how he got from that far country back home. But long ways, broke and hungry. On his way home, that boy is reciting his speech. He's trying to figure out what he's going to say because he messed up. He's going to go back. He must have a story. Is it going to be a true story? Or some kind of phony story? Some kind of fake story? So he concludes to himself that he's going to ask his dad, could you hire me as a servant? He gets within range of the house. The story gets to what the end, the Bible says, his father saw him from afar off. From afar off. His father saw him from afar off. He runs to meet him. him, kisses him. And I assume the boy is trying to now recite his story. He has prepared this story, and he's beginning to say a few words, but his father is saying, later. Not now. Story says that the father calls his servants and says, listen, get me some clean clothes. Get me some shoes. Story says he then calls for a ring to be placed on his finger. A ring? Yes. Because that dad is not just going to give him a job. He wants to be a hired hand. Because as I told you earlier, when he left, he cut ties. Now he's coming back, and his father is saying, man, I am reinstating you. Not just as a servant, but as a son. The story says his father saw him, man, afar off. You see, my brothers and my sisters, the eyes of mercy are quicker than the eyes of repentance. God sees a sinner long before the sinner sees God. Sometimes you wonder. When you're in that party hall, is God there? That's why I say, parents, when those children begin to wander away and you can't tell them anything, now you can't say a word. You can't whip him anymore. All you can do is pray. Pray. The eyes of the sinner, as that boy begins to come toward the house, I don't know whether he saw the father, but the Bible says the father saw him. What do you think the father saw? What do you think the father saw? I think that when the father looked at him, the father saw exactly where he had come from. The father saw his dress. The father saw his swineherd's dress. The father saw the filth upon his hands and feet. The father saw his rags. The father saw his look, the look in his eyes. The father saw where he had been. The father saw what he was. The father saw, however, what he could soon be. His father saw him from afar off. See, God has a way of seeing us that we cannot understand. Think God knows what's going on with you right now? Yes. God is able to see you through and through. The father runs out, fell on his neck, kissed him. Now all of that stuff was really strange behavior. When you consider the culture, all of that was strange behavior. But my brothers and my sisters, this story speaks about the abundant grace of a loving God. God does not operate in ways that we think he should. All God wants is for us to come home, and God is ready and God is waiting to receive us. God is ready and God is waiting to forgive us. That is what I call grace. Is what I call grace. Many of us have left home in many ways. We have already left. Some of us have left home and have made materialism a god. Some of us have made our education a god. Some of us have made our property a god. Many of us have already left home, but I'm saying to you this morning, my brothers and my sisters, this story should give us hope because it speaks of a God that is loving and full of grace.
Have you ever felt like the prodigal son? You really messed up. Maybe something at home or something at work. And you return home, you rehearse what you're going to say, just as the young man does in this parable. Perhaps you're working on some kind of excuse. Notice that this prodigal son makes no excuse. He comes straight home, expecting that his father would give him an assignment with the servants. But his father was waiting and watching.
All God wants is for us to come to our senses and make a commitment to come home.
So picture it with me. Boy is coming. I don't know if the father gets some hint. Boys in the area, in the neighborhood. Father sits out there on the block. He's looking up. He's looking down. And something catches his eyes. Way down the block. Father looks again. Now the old man can hardly see. But he looks again, and down the block it looks, because that walk, I know that walk. Father begins to walk down the block toward that figure that he sees in the distance.
But as he gets closer and he discovers that this is indeed my boy, my own flesh and blood. He's my firstborn.
No, he was a younger one.
Oh, yes, Jesus.
And the father begins to run toward the boy. He gets to him. He hugs him. Oh, my boy was lost.
Now notice the word in the text. The Bible says, father declares, my son was dead. Listen to me. There are a lot of people you see walking around. Walking dead. All God wants is for you to come home. That's all he asks. Come home. So if I'm driving down the street, and they did something on Linden Boulevard, that is, you're driving down Linden Boulevard now, you can't drive more than 30 miles an hour. So a friend of mine from Connecticut was traveling. He drives to my house, and then he picks me up, and I am now driving him to the airport because I'm going to keep his car until he returns. I'm driving down Linden Boulevard. I'm heading to the airport. I didn't even know. A couple of weeks later, I got a call from my friend. He said, you got a ticket. 30 miles.
But assume that I'm going down the street and I'm speeding. I'm going well beyond the speed limit. And the police, you begin to see those lights and they hear the sound of the sirens. Oh, man. It just happened to me a couple of times. You pull over. The police comes to the window.
And you know the little bit of a routine. You sit there, your hands on the steering wheel, and you wait for the man. He comes to your window, he asks for your license and your registration, and you get in there, you pull out your license and your registration, but I'll tell you, I pull out my little ministerial license. I hand it to the man. You know, I was speeding one night away from church. I was coming from church, getting right there on my block. I was up in Connecticut at the time. Right there on my block, and I'm getting down the block, and I was in a hurry to get home. Pulled into my driveway, and as I got there in my driveway to the stop, right behind me, into my driveway, was the policeman, and he pulled right in. I stepped out of my car. The man says, "No, you sit back in there." I sat back and said, you know, went in, and he asked for my license and my registration, and I handed him the thing, and he said, "Oh, that's not your license. Pastor Francis." So I said, I probably was in a hurry, officer. I was out all day in a hurry to get home. But I've introduced myself to the man as an honest citizen. The man looked at me and he said, "Is that where you live?" I said, "Sure, that's my home." He gave me back my documents and he said, "You be careful next time." Grace. That is what she calls grace. That is what she calls grace. Because that man could have given me a ticket. He could have written me a summons. He could have said, "Pastor Francis, on this block, what you did tonight was so dangerous. The children could have been running up and down the streets. And that could have been so serious. I am going to, you are going to be severely punished." But the man gave me a break. Now, I really was supposed to get the ticket. Well, but the man gave me a break. That's grace. Now, grace is getting something that you do not deserve. You really deserve to get this, but I'm going to give you that. Amen. What do you think that boy should have gotten when he came home? What do you think he should have gotten? Obviously, there was nothing left for him. He had already gotten his share. He had already taken everything. He'd gone. He had used it. You'd done nothing, nothing, nothing. As some dad would have said to him, "Man, keep on stepping. Keep on stepping." But grace says, regardless of what you have done, in spite of what you have done, listen to me, my brothers and my sisters, that is why grace is something that you ought to be so thankful for, God's grace. Because if you understand yourself, when you come to yourself, you'll understand that you don't deserve it. And some of my members who are here at church every Sabbath and you're already ready to go to heaven and you think that you are already arrived. Let me burst your bubble a little bit. Because were it not for the grace of God, you would have been somewhere else this morning. You could have been in a pigsty somewhere. But it is only because of God's grace.
So somebody's listening to the preacher this morning and you think, you're okay, man, I got it covered. I got a good little bank account and everything. I got a few stocks and my future looks bright. I got a house here in New York. I have something vacationing somewhere in the South. And I still have a little business back in Jamaica. And you got everything settled and you think, huh? Now, when you woke up this morning, you thought that you had a right to be alive because you have enough money in the bank? You think that I am entitled to be here because I am secure financially and otherwise? Listen to me, people, listen to me. You have to be careful how you live your life. You have to be careful about the attitude you walk through life with. Watch that attitude, watch that attitude. Don't ever think that you got things under control. You got nothing. Because if God decides one morning that, man, you know what? I'm going to allow a few things to blow by this fellow down there. He's a little too pompous with himself. Now, the next thing I've discovered in my little life is that, listen, there are some things you can't explain. You just can't explain how you got from point A to point B. You remember you were walking around. You were walking around back there, brother Gilbert, in Trinidad. You were walking around there, and you didn't have any shoes to wear. You remember those days? You had no shoes. You had one pair of pants, and when I was growing up, I knew a few fellows who had no pants. That's not funny, because I know some of my young people listening to me now, they're wondering, is he speaking truth? Absolute truth. Running around the village with no pants on. But you can't explain. You can't explain. Could you really explain how you got from no pants and now you're well educated and you're well set up and well established, and now you're walking around as though you, man, you're all that and a bag and so on. But truth be told, the only reason you were able to make it from A to B is only because of God's grace. God's grace. God's grace. So the Bible says that Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden. I'm going to close now. I'm going to keep my promise. Would somebody move the hand of the clock back a little bit? God came down there in the Garden of Eden. He met Adam and Eve, who had just messed up big time. Adam and Eve had messed up big time. And God said, you see the tree? Don't touch it. Don't touch it. If you touch it, you're going to die. Adam and Eve went there, they touched, and they ate. Now they're supposed to die. Instead of God, you know, God had options in the Garden of Eden. God could have just killed them and made himself some new people. God could have done that. That would have been a nice thing for God to do. But God, the Bible says, decided right there that he would set in motion what we now know as the plan of salvation. God himself decided he was going to leave heaven and come down to earth. He was going to die. And he was going to pay the penalty for man's sin. That is what we call grace. Something you did not deserve. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death. That is what sin should have brought us. But the Bible also says that the gift of God is eternal life. That is what we call grace. Grace. So you're looking at me this morning, and God has somehow allowed you to be here at the church today. I want you to walk out of this church full of gratitude. Of gratitude. Saying, God, I'm what I am because of your grace. God, I'm who I am because of your grace. God, the only reason I am what I am today is because of your grace. So God, thank you. Thank you for grace. Thank you for grace. Lorena, where's that song you were trying to sing this morning? Is she still have it upstairs? You still have a Lorena's song up there, Lakeisha? That's a good song to play right now. Thank you because of your grace. And grace will not only save us now, but the old gospel song says, grace will lead us home. Grace will lead us home. Today, somebody wants to say, thank you, God. Thank you, God, for your grace. I understand that I may have messed up, but God, your grace is sufficient for me. Your grace is sufficient for me. Somebody may have come to visit today and you know, you're kind of just wandering around, you know, you've sort of turned your back a little bit on God, but listen to the story this morning. This story should give you hope. That God is not going to turn his back on you. No matter how far you've gone, no matter how deep you've gone, God is waiting for you. He's waiting. He's waiting for you. You got that song, Lakeisha? Yeah, I'm holding. She's going to get it. She's going to get it. So I want to give somebody the opportunity today to say, thank you, God. And I want to give somebody the opportunity today to say, God, I'm coming home. The tracks. God, I'm coming home. Somebody today can decide to go, come back home. I want to give somebody that opportunity today. Bow your heads. Let us pray. Gracious Father, thank you for this story. It gives us the assurance that in spite of ourselves, you, God, still willing to extend your grace to us. God, we thank you that your grace is still active. So as we speak to God right now, if there's somebody today who would just like to say, God, thank you for your grace. I know that I went far and wide. I wait not for your grace. I would have been something else today. I would have been somebody else today. Somebody wants to say, thank you, God. You want to thank God for his grace? Wave your hand in the heavens. God's going to see. That looks like everybody. And as we continue to pray, Father, there just may be somebody in the house today who wants to say to you, I'm coming home. I'm coming home. If you like that today, and as we pray, I want to pray for you. Is there somebody today who wants to say, I'm coming home? Wave a hand. Wave a hand. I see hands. I see hands.
Father, you've seen those hands. These are your children coming home. Like you did for that boy in the story. Give somebody today the sweet assurance of salvation. Let them know that they're just not hired servants, but they're children. God, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. It's too low, but I'll sing it anyway. Back to where I started from. I know you a miracle of love, not wrong. Just an old sinner saved by grace. Just a sinner saved by grace. When I stood condemned, I'm just a sinner. God for his grace. See what grace can cause you to do? Grace can cause you to do a lot of things. God is good, isn't he? God is so good. I pray that those of you who've come to worship with us today really would have enjoyed your worship experience. Please, feel free to come again. It's an open invitation. And enjoy God's grace. Bask in his grace. And as you go from here, don't ever take God for granted. Don't ever take God for granted. Live your life in full recognition of the Father's love for you. That's my prayer for you today. In his name.
Please stand.